One of my favorites, hail. Like if you stub your toe and you say, ah, hail, or I'm a Catholic, Hail Mary. Hail is condensation, freezing, then falling. Notice the sequence. Condensation is going to happen up in the cloud first, so water's going to come out in the liquid form, then it's going to freeze, then it will fall to the ground. That's what hail is. Hail is always associated with violent weather. I will say this again later on in this section of the course, but I'm telling you now, hail is always associated with violent weather. So when you're in an area where there's hail, the atmosphere is violent. It's caused because of very strong updrafts of air within the cloud. So in other words, instead of the wind blowing horizontally across the surface, the wind blows vertically upwards away from the surface, higher up into the atmosphere. If a little raindrop is forming in the bottom of the cloud and it gets hit by one of these strong updrafts within the cloud, what's going to happen? The raindrops are thrown higher up into the cloud. And of course, in the troposphere, the higher up you go, what happens to air temperature? Air temperature goes down. So when they get to that higher altitude, it's colder up there, they freeze. That's how you make hail. Take a look at this diagram. Notice on the left-hand side it says warm updraft. What that means is that you have this warm wind that's blowing up into the clouds. At the bottom of the cloud, as you can see on the left-hand side, raindrops are forming. But because of that updraft of air, this vertically moving wind, those raindrops, instead of falling to the ground, are thrown higher up into the cloud. Once they pass that dotted line that says freezing level, the temperature up there is below 32 degrees Fahrenheit or 0 degrees Celsius. What happens to the water at that point is it freezes solid. Now you can see in the middle where it says rain freezes into hail and grows larger, and there's this circle that's going around. What typically happens is the hailstone will then begin to fall down through the cloud, and as it does, it once again passes the freezing level, although it's below the freezing level. So in other words, it's warmer than freezing down below that, closer to the ground. And water forms around the hailstone, liquid water, because of condensation. Remember, the hailstone's a solid object, and water has to form on something. Then it gets thrown back up again. When it does, that water that just formed around the hailstone freezes again. And each time it goes around, what do you think's happening? It gets bigger and bigger and bigger. At some point, either A, the winds break down and the hailstone falls to the ground, or B, it gets so large it can't be held up and it's not buoyant enough anymore, and down it comes. Either way, look at this. I took this picture in a little town in the Czech Republic. I used to own a house in the Czech Republic. We have friends there, and every other year or so, we go and visit them. This little town has a spa. It's famous for mud. So you put mud all over you as if this is good for you, but I go along with the game. Back in the Middle Ages, they dug out these huge open pits that then they fill with water, and they use them as fish ponds, so a version of aquaculture. It's still a great place to eat fish. They still fish farm in those ponds. And it's flat, so it's a great place to ride bikes. We were there a couple of years ago, and I heard this incredible raucous noise happening outside our hotel. I looked outside, and this incredible hail was falling. You can see how big it is on the left-hand side. This went on for 45 minutes. I ran outside to move the car because I was afraid the car would get damaged. And just going through that for 30 seconds, getting hit by hailstones that big, being pelted in that way, it's painful. Now, if you look at the right-hand side, you could see, if you look carefully at that hailstone, it's a whole bunch of small hailstones that have all glued together because of what I said. There's a vast amount of water that was being squeezed out of the cloud, and there were very strong updrafts of the air in the cloud, and the hailstones kept going around. Every time they come down through the bottom, liquid water would get on them, they bump into each other, they get thrown up higher, and it froze into that very large hailstone. Freezing rain and sleet. Although these are different, we're going to group them together, but they're very similar to each other. In order to make freezing rain or sleet, what happens is this: it's condensation falling, then freezing. Notice how this is different from hail. Because with hail, it's condensation freezing, then falling. This is condensation falling, then freezing, which means there's an inversion layer because the air above is warmer than the air below. As the rain falls, it's going to pass either through a freezing layer of air or it's going to hit the ground and the ground itself is frozen. One of those two things. If it hits the ground, and it freezes on the ground as an ice sheet on the ground or on some object, that's called freezing rain. If it freezes in the air en route to the ground while it's falling, that's called sleet. So it starts as rain and freezes on the way down to the ground, or it freezes when it hits frozen surfaces like the ground. In other words, the car is below 32 degrees, or the ground is below 32 degrees, liquid water hits it, and then it freezes. Or the rain's coming down and it passes through a layer of cold air. We'll see both. This is associated with warm fronts. Now, we haven't spoken about warm fronts yet, but the fronts are coming. I will remind you when I talk about a warm front that these are associated with both freezing rain and sleet. This is what a warm front looks like, or a diagram of one. If you look on the left-hand side, you can see it says warm air, and then down on the ground, you can see it says 53 degrees. Up above, you can see it says wind, and that's pointing a direction that's going from left to right. Then down below, you can see it says cold air receding and it says 22 degrees. And then to the left of that, it says 32 degrees. What's happening is this: the warm air is flowing along the surface of the planet and it hits that cold air. Warm air wants to rise. So the warm air rises over the top of the cold air that's down below. This is typical of what would happen. Cold air is heavier, wants to stay down. Warm air is lighter, it wants to rise above. But what that does is it creates an inversion. Because now you have the warmer air above and the colder air below. That means that where the clouds are forming, condensation is occurring. Then that condensation turns into rain and the rain begins to fall. And you can see that down below, there's an area where you have some snow that's out coming from the higher elevation of the clouds, but the lower elevations of the clouds, you can see that other stuff that's coming down, that would be sleet. So you have warmer air above. And then the rain falls through the colder air and it solidifies en route to the ground. This is freezing rain. Take a look at that. If you live in California, you don't even know what that is. But if you look at it, what happened was the car in the middle of the night was below 32 degrees Fahrenheit. It began to rain. And when it did, this is in winter in the Midwest, when it began to rain, the rain would hit the car and begin to freeze, but it would begin to drip a little bit, then it would freeze, drip a little, freeze. And if you look at it carefully, it's almost like it's a frozen waterfall. Remarkable. Now, back east, this is sometimes known as black ice when it forms on the ground. You can see why. You can see the black top to the left-hand side. So asphalt is dark. When freezing rain occurs on asphalt, it makes this sheet of ice that is transparent. You're driving your car along on the street, then suddenly you hit the black ice. When you do, now your car is effectively on an ice rink. And of course, what happens is your car skitters all over the place and slams into things. The next time you're in the upper Midwest or back east, take a look at the cars. Many of the cars, if they're 10 or 15 years old, are going to have dings all over them, or they have body rot underneath. The reason they have dings is because they bump into a lot of things as a result of hitting the black ice. The reason they have body rot is because the government, in order to break up that ice, throws either salt or ash on the ground. Both of those things lower the temperature at which the water freezes, but then that gets all over the bottom of the car. And when it gets all over the bottom of the car, it rots away the bottom of the car and the sides of the car. The first car I bought was a 68 Volkswagen Squareback when I was 18 in 1981. That car had come from Cincinnati to Southern California. And the entire side and bottom of the car had body rot. In fact, where the clutch was at, because it was a manual transmission automobile on the left-hand side, there was a hole in the floorboard as big as my hand. So when I drove the car, I would watch the street going by underneath me. This was because of the body rot as a result of trying to break up freezing rain.